العالمين على سيد المرسلين وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. My dear respected brothers, welcome again to our regular Sunday class about Bulugh al-Maram. And as you know that we are still studying the book of selling and buying, what we call it business transaction, and therefore today inshallah we'll continue what we already started before inshallah ta'ala. I need just for me to bring my book. So check my internet connection because it was weak. So alhamdulillah. طيب. So last time, as you remember, we have been studying some hadith which relate to riba. And today, inshallah, we'll continue, you know, as we use. So let's go to the hadith that we stopped. Right. So today the hadith, it was narrated by Samura ibn Jundub, radiallahu anhu. Who said the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam prohibited selling animals for animals on delay payment. Related by the five Imams, at-Tirmidhi and Ibn al-Jarud. And graded Sahih. This is the view of some ulama. But this hadith, in fact, is contradict with the following hadith, which is an Ibn Umar radiallahu anhu. Or it's not this one, but another hadith which before this, which talk about selling camels by when the camel is a sadaqah will come. Inshallah, we'll come to this hadith. Now let's concentrate on this hadith. If we took this hadith, that means animal with animal. When we talk about animal, that means animal, living animal. Because if it was not living, then we'll say it meat. But here we talk about animal, which means that you cannot give a cow for a cow, for example, you know, for delaying. That means you take one and leave the other. This applying what we talk about in gold and other you know, production that we already discussed before. But as you said, this hadith, in fact, it's mean don't sell, for example, goat for goat, or one goat with two goats, or two sheep, or one camel with two camels, or one cow with two cows, or to delay, because according to this, the hadith make it some type of riba. But as I said, this hadith was considered as weak in the view of many scholars. Therefore, this rule is not applied. Why? Because whenever we speak, whenever we discuss about a hadith, if the hadith is weak, the ulama will not take it as proof or as foundation for rules in fiqh. Only they take the sahih or the hasan. That graded hasan mean okay or sound, or sahih, which is authentic. These are the level of a hadith that ulama accept when they take it as proof or evidences or as dalil for any rule. Therefore, some ulama, they said, this hadith is not strong and it's weak, and therefore it's not applied. The other hadith, I'm trying to find it here, but I don't know, this edition of this book doesn't show here. I'm trying to find it. With hadith ibn Umar radiallahu an. Yes, this is the hadith. Hadith ibn Umar radiallahu an, which said, the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam commanded him, Abdullah ibn Umar, the Prophet commanded Abdullah ibn Umar to prepare an army. It seemed that, you know, they are preparing for, war or for some type of defense. And therefore, he commanded Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As to prepare for the army. But the camels he had were insufficient. That means they don't have enough camels. And, you know, at that time, people, you know, when they go to war or they travel, they use camels as rides. So this is of their weapon. They use horses and camels so they can travel. They can use it in the war. So some people, he said, remained without camel to ride. Some of the army, seems that the army want to move to an area which is far away a little bit. Therefore, they need rides. So some of the army, some men, soldiers, Sahaba, they want to join this expedition. They didn't find a ride. So the Messenger of Allah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam ordered him to buy camels in exchange for young camels of zakah. Now look at this. Buy camels. No problem with this. But where's the price? There's no money now. And there's nothing to be paid for the seller of these camels, that we want to get their camels from them. So the Messenger of Allah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam told him to take it or make a deal with them. Go and find someone who have camels and make a deal with him and tell him that we will give you young camels of the zakah. But this camel is not available now. That means it will come at the time when the Prophet ﷺ collect the zakah from tribes. So which means the price or the exchange is delayed. See, the amount or the exchange for the camels they want to buy from these traders is delayed because it's not available now. They are waiting for zakah to come, and therefore they will pay them for the camels that which the army is in need now. So he said, tell them that when the zakah come, when we collect the zakah, we'll give them from this young camels that will get as zakah. So what he said, Abdullah said, I used to exchange two of the young camels zakah, two camels, for one camel. Now look at this transaction. One camel is available now in the hand of whom? The seller in the market. They have old camels. I need it for my army. I take one. I want to pay them back. I don't have money. I don't have any exchange. I will tell you, I will give it to you later when I receive the zakah. I'll give you as a price for your one camel. I'll give you two camels. Now, if you apply this to the previous hadith, the hadith of Samura, who said animal with animal is riba, that means this transaction considered as riba. So here, someone may say there's contradiction. So what did the scholars say? And how they make, you know, understanding of both hadith? So the scholars mentioned that this hadith is more sound, more authentic, and also supported by other hadith. While the previous one, hadith of Samura, that animal with animal is riba, is not that authentic. It's not that strong. So what we learn from this, according to this, that it is okay. It is okay. Therefore, we said it is permissible to give an animal in exchange of better animal or more of the same type. That's when you go, you give two of your strong young, for example, a young camel or young horses for one or two or three. It doesn't mean, you know, they should be equal either in number or even that you pay later. So it's not type of riba. So this is the purpose of this, of mentioning this hadith. This is why Al-Musayyib said, La riba fil hayawan. La riba fil hayawan. There is no riba in exchanging animals. The next hadith, I hope this is very clear. Just to summarize what I said. There is one hadith of Samura which said that exchanging animal with animal is riba. Same like gold, same like green, same like dates, whatever I mentioned before. But we said this hadith is not strong enough. There are other hadith which is more stronger, more sound, which was rated by Abdullah bin Amr ibn al-As, which said that the Prophet ﷺ commanded him to prepare an army. And since the army need for camels, which is not available for people to ride, so he promised the traders or those who have or own camels for sale that he take one camel from them, and later on, when the camels or young camels come at the time of collecting the zakah, they will get two in exchange for one they give. So this is what we conclude. And we concluded from this, based on this hadith, then exchange animal with animal, not considered as riba. So I hope this is very, very clear. Now let's go to the next one, but we'll go back a little bit here, because the order is, it's not the same in all edition. عند ابن عمر رضي الله عنهما قال سمعت رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يقول إذا تبعتم بالعين. Let's go to the translation. ابن عمر رضي الله عنه narrated, I hear the messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم said, when you practice العينة, same. I will explain this, what does it mean العينة. So this is Arabic word. العينة, we'll explain it at the end after we finish the hadith. Getting hold of the tail of the cows, that's mean getting busy with the with farming, feeling content with agriculture and neglecting jihad, Allah will bring upon you humiliation and disgrace, which He will not lift until you revert to your religion. Now this hadith, let's take it one by one. So he said, Al-Ina. What's mean Al-Ina? Al-Ina, that to sell something to someone that he gave you money to sell it. Let's say it again. That's mean you come to a person and you said, I want to buy this car from you. Great. For how much? For 50 riyals. But I don't have money. I will give you the 50,000 riyal after 1 year or after 2 years or whatever. So he said, okay, I will sell you my car for 50,000 riyal that you'll give it to me later on. But then when he said, okay, this is the car is yours, what happened? This person who bought the car, he will sell it again to the seller with less price. Okay, now he said, okay, Will you now buy it from me for 30,000 riyal? 30,000 riyal? Then he said, okay. So, which means he will take it now. So he will give him 30,000 riyal. 30,000 riyal. So in fact, he borrowed 30,000 riyal and he will retain it as 50,000 riyal after 1 year or any other, you know, time they assign. So this car, which is in the middle, it's just a trick. You know, so instead, not directly, he said to him, please, I'm in need for 50,000 riyal and you give it to me. I will retain it to you later. And he said, this is riba. So what they do, they make this trick and they put this car or carpet or whatever, you know, as in the middle. In fact, they are deceiving themselves because this is a trick and this is not correct. So here, it's not only one mistake or one sin. First of all, it is riba. Second, it is trick. And trick, making trick with whom? With Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who knows what's in your heart and what's your plan. So the Einah, again, إذا تبايعتم بالعينة, when you use the way of عينه transaction, what is it, دعينه؟ دعينه is when person he will sell a product to the same person that he bought it from him, but he get the money from the first person, the buyer, and he get money at the end because he's already borrowed the money for this product from him, which is a trick. So this is the meaning of this عينة. طيب, let's say it again because maybe some people get confused. The buyer person come to buy a car and he said, will you sell me this car with 50,000 riyal and I will pay you the money after 1 year. So we have two people. One who has a car. One, he wants the money. So he will come to the owner of the car and said, I want you to sell me your car for 50,000 riyal that I don't have now. I will give it to you, you know, after 1 year. And then the buyer or the seller, he said, okay, no problem. This is my car. Now my car is yours. They write paper and everything that it is yours. What is the price? I will pay it after 1 year, 50,000 riyal. And then after they finish this stage, he will tell him, now I want to sell the car. Will you buy it from me? So the seller himself will take it. He said, okay, I take the car, which is now yours, for only 30,000 riyal. Will you accept? He said, okay, but I need the money now. Okay, no problem, take the money. So what happened? He took 30,000 riyal, he put it in his pocket, and he left, and there was no car. The car is there. So this is trick. How can we get from this? There is a way, a form, which now used by banks here, they call it tawarruq. Tawarruq, that means, you know, to get cash. How to get cash? They call it tawarruq. This is what they do now in some banks here. Which, it is exactly the same scenario with one difference. That the buyer, the second buyer, is not the same person who sold the product from the beginning. Let's go to our example. So you come to a person and ask him to sell you this car. Let's say that you go to Toyota, for example, company, or any company. And you say to them, I want a car, but I don't have money. They said, okay, sign paper that you will pay it in 2 years or 3 years or any time. And they agree. And they give you the key of the car. and you didn't pay any money because you'll pay them later. No problem with this, to buy a car and pay later. But then here you took this car from the company and you go outside and sold it to other people, to a person different than the company or the person that he sold you the car. This is okay. Even you sold it with less amount. Because, you know, when you get a car, for example, a car with 100,000 riyal, new car, and you go outside to sell it, nobody will buy it at the same price. Because people, if they want to buy it from the same price, they will go to the company, to the agent. They will not come to you. But, you know, to make it, you know, easy so we can sell it. So we'll say, this car is new. And the mileage is zero. And I will sell it to you for 70,000 riyal. While you will pay 100,000 riyal after 1 year or after 2 years. And you sold it. Is this okay? Now, ulama have two views regarding this. Some of the ulama, they said, this is also, it's trick and it's including in riba. But some ulama said, in this way, it's okay when it is needed. When it is needed. That's mean a person, he has a house. He want to build his home. And he was in a lack of cash. He doesn't have enough money to finish his apartment or house when he built it. And he needs some cash. Wherever he go to borrow, nobody will give him money. So what he can do? So he go, he buy a car, for example, in installment for 100 or 80,000 riyal, and then take it and go outside and to sell it to anyone. So he will sell it for 50,000 riyal. So he gets 50,000 riyal at least in his pocket, even that he will pay about 80 or more later. So I hope this form is clear. So there is two now, we have two different forms. One is haram, and one according to some scholars that it is okay. The first one is ina, and the second one called tawarru. The ina, when the transaction come or happened between only two parties, buying from the second party, okay, and then sell it to him again, sell it to the same owner of the car or the product that you bought this product from him for a delay price. So this is called ina. But if it was sold to a third party, then it's called tawarruq, and it is okay. طيب. So, and then the hadith said, when getting hold of the tails of the cows, what does this mean? You know, people, they use cows, you know, and bulls in their farms for farming the land. So the farmer, when he go with this cow that's used to farm the land, he will walk behind it to hold maybe the metals or whatever that he uses. So this is expression that you get involved in what? In farming and agriculture. So this is, like, is farming and agriculture is bad business? No. In fact, farming and agriculture business is the best, one of the best and one of the good. And you know, just remember that the Prophet ﷺ mentioned in one hadith that if the Muslim, he plant one plant, any tree that you plant, he will get rewarded for everybody that may benefit from this tree. Maybe a bird that will eat, or any insect or anything. Any living being that benefit from the plant that you planted, you will get reward. So in fact, agriculture and farming, this is very blessed work. But why here it was condemned? It was condemned when it's keep us busy, keep ourselves busy with this worldly affair, and we forgot with something which is most important, which is defending the religion, defending Islam, defending the Islamic land. So this is a point here why the Prophet ﷺ said, when you keep yourself busy only in business and in farming and this world, and you don't care about taking care of protecting the Islam and Islamic land, then you will be humiliated by your enemies. طيب. The next hadith, which by Abi Umama radiallahu anhu. Abu Umama radiallahu anhu narrated that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, if anyone intercedes for his brother, that's meaning Islam, and he is giving a present in return for his favor, and he accepts, he is guilty of practicing great type of riba. Now, what does this mean? Now, this hadith, anyway, it is da'if, but ulama, they took something about it. Now, what do you mean by intercession here? Intercession that when you help somebody to get something, and there are three types of intercession. Some are forbidden, some are recommended, some is okay. For example, if you are an officer in one company or any administration, and they, you are in charge to hire people, and then someone come to intercede for someone, you know, this is what you call it, wasita here. It takes someone to help you to get this job. Because you know the friend of this person or one of his relatives, you will go to him and he said, well, I'm in need for this job. I don't have a job. I'm jobless. He will go with you and he talk to this officer and tell him, please hire this person, hire so and so. Now, while this, he has a list of some candidate, some of them, and this one is one of the candidates. They have a list of 10 people and they want to choose maybe two or three of them. And there are some people who are more eligible, deserve this position, but because this officer, he know you, and you brought this person and told him, please help him, he will replace one of those who deserve this position. He kicked them away and he hired this person. This type of interception is what is forbidden. Why? Because it's taking the right of someone else who deserves it. This is unjust. This is unjust. Because this person who submitted his application and he is eligible for this job, or the only problem that he doesn't know you and you didn't intercept for him. And this, my dear brothers, it's happened, unfortunately, because some people are loyal for their nationality or their family members or their countrymen or the, you know, people or the neighbor or their friends. So they go with them, they try to support them to take something which is not them, which is not there. Like, as I said, in a position of company. And this happened in many companies. You see, a person who is in charge, he may not give this position to somebody who have the best qualification to fill this position. And you will give it to somebody who doesn't meet this qualification or less than, not the same standard of the other place, of the other man, just because you know him. So this is called wasita here, you know, and they call it also interception. This is shafa'a. In the Arabic form, it said as-shafa'a. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَمَنْ يَشْفَعْ شَفَاعَةً حَسَنَةً يَكُنْ لَهُ نَصِيبٌ مِّنْهَا. The one who make intercession in something which is good, that has no injustice with others, then this will be by the will of Allah rewarded. So this first one is not forbidden. طيب. Other type, which is highly recommended. Highly recommended. Like what? Like, for example, you know a laborer that he didn't get his payment because his boss always delay his payment. And he met you or his neighbor or knew about him, and you told him, he told you that, you know, I didn't get my payment for a long time now. And you know the owner of this company or the person in charge of the financial department, and you walk with him or you go to them and said, please, will you give this person is my neighbor? He is praying with me. He is my friend. Okay. And he is in need. So please pay him his money. So because they respect you, they know you, what they do, they said, okay, no problem. And they give him his cash and his money. Now you help him to get his right. Is this okay or not? Yes, in fact, highly recommended. And this is Allah. The Prophet ﷺ said, ishfa'u ta'jur. In this, any intercession that the Muslim do to help someone to get his right, or to push away any harm, this is highly recommended and this is rewarded. So this is the third type, the second type. So there is one forbidden when it's intercession that will lead to take the right of someone else and give it to the one that you intercede for him. This is forbidden, haram, injustice. And it is recommended, highly recommended, and you know that. And rewarded if you are helping someone to get his right or to push away any harm from someone, maybe harm him if you didn't help him. Now, the third type, you can get him, you can help him without affecting the rights of anybody else. And there's no problem. For example, there is a company, they have position for 50. They need 50 laborers. And those who submitted their application, only 40. And you go with this one and tell them, you know, and help him to get this, no problem. As long as he didn't take or he was replaced someone who is more right in this position. I hope this is... Now, why the Shaykh mentioned this in Arabia? Because this is benefiting also. This is a matter of profit, but in different way. In different way, it's not only in money, but only here in intercession. So this is the point. Why? طيب. The last hadith that we'll talk about, hadith of Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As, رضي الله عنه. Abdullah ibn Amr ibn al-As said, narrated, that the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam cursed the one who bribes and the one who accepts the bribes related by Abu Dawud. Al-Rashi wal-Murtashi. So it's forbidden, my dear brothers and sisters, to take bribes on something that you have to do. You know, some, for example, some workers or some people, you know, they are in their business, in their offices. And you need service from them. You go every day there and say, hey, tomorrow, okay, it's not. But you hear that this person, he do this, he delay people, so they give him money or they give him some pride. So they, if someone gave him money, or bribe, then he will do it quickly. This is haram. Haram to give it to him, and it is forbidden for him to take it. And there is a hadith said, وَالرَّائِشُ بَيْنَهُمَا. It's not here. There is another narration, which said that the Prophet ﷺ caused three: al-Rashi, wal-Murtashi, wal-Ra'ish. Al-Rashi, the one who gives the pride. Al-Murtashi, the one who takes the pride. Al-Ra'ish, the one who arranged between the two sides. Because you don't know this person that, you know, he took money, but somebody outside, he will tell you, okay, you want to solve your problem, just give 5,000 riyal. And, you know, your problem will be settled. And maybe he do it for his benefit also. Maybe he's already have an arrangement with this person that he take part or portion or percentage of this bribe. So the Muslim should stay away from this because this is haram. It is haram, and the Muslim should not go to bribe anyone. There is system, there is rule that he can follow, and he can get his rights without using this indirect way, or it's not clear way, because this person who takes this money, he take it without right. He is there at this position to serve people. Why he take money? He's already paid for his work. Why he put pressure on people to take their money without right? And if people, they do this, then yani, this, unfortunately, it will make corruption. So workers, they will not do their job unless they get some money. This is why, unfortunately, in some Muslim community, always they say this is a practice. If you didn't give anything, then you will not get through and get your rights or do your work or business. This is the reason here. And this is why the ulama said to give money to someone who is already paid for what he is doing, this is a crime. So for example now, if you hire, you have contract with a company, and the company sent an engineer or technician to fix what you have. You know, some people, they give bakhshish. They give some money for this technician who come to them. Hope that he will be, you know, give better job or take good care of this work. This is something they consider this as bribe. Said, no, I didn't mean to bribe him. He's already, this is just like bakhshish or like, you know, they call it tips or something of this. No, this is bribe. Why? Because when he come to you, he's already paid. This is his job. Why should you give him money for this? So my dear brothers and sisters, we should be aware of this kind of dealing when we deal with people, because we try our best to stay away from whatever forbidden. So we'll stop here. It is already 7:14, and I think there's some question from last week and one question from yesterday. I will start with one sister. She asked in our class yesterday if there is iqama for women. I mean, they can make iqama in salah. Ulama have different view. In fact, the iqama and the adhan is the announcement of the time, and this is for men, and the jama'ah generally for men. So it's not required from ladies to make adhan or iqama. But some ulama said, if she made iqama, it's okay. But the most important thing, that in a voice that cannot be heard by someone who is not mahram, like alone here in her room, she can make iqama, no problem. Or a group of women, and this was reported by Aisha radiallahu anha, she sometimes leads women in salah, and they make iqama and they pray. So this is the view of Shaykh bin al-Thaymin. So if it was done without the presence of men who are not maharim, it's okay, inshallah. But it's not must, and it's not because this is for men mostly. Right. We'll stop here. So if you have any question, please you can ask. Barakallah. Yes. Any question? Okay, do we have question from last week or sent to group?
Assalamu alaikum, Sheikh.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullah. Naam.
You can hear me properly.
Go ahead.
I'm just want to know if what if someone asked me to be a sales lady in a store, like there's a haram to sell. Can I accept that job or no? Like there's a wine inside. It's like a sari-sari store or something like that, but mixed with the haram, like wine, like pork noodles, like that, with the pork something.
You mean you go to a shop for grocery, for example, you want to buy something, but this place they sell something which is haram, right?
No, they want like I'm going to work that store. Me.
You want to work in that store?
A sales lady, like yes. What if like that happened? Is it
no? Well, okay? my dear sister, yes, I got your question. Is it okay to work in a place where they sell something which is forbidden? Correct.
Yes, like that.
Okay. Well, it is better for the Muslim to stay away from any shubha, any place. So if this grocery, they are selling pork or wine, then should not work there. But in case of necessity, that means this is the only type of job that is available. Then we will look, is what you are doing connected to this matter, I mean to selling this product, then we should not. But if it's like, for example, like administering something which is far away from that transaction that happened, then it is okay. But to be in the safe side, it's better not to work in such places. And just remember that if the Muslim stay away from something which is prohibited and haram, because he fear Allah Azza wa Jal, Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala will replace for him better, a job or better replacement for what he left. Now, our admin, do we have question from groups from last week?
It's already answered, Dr. Yahya, the one you just mentioned now. Alhamdulillah.
Okay. طيب. Any question? Okay. جزاكم الله خير. So then we'll stop here and we'll meet inshallah next week at 6:30. I just would like to remind you, next week we have a general lecture, which is our monthly meeting, talking about misconception about Islam. The topic will be about polygamy. It will be, inshallah, discussed in detail on Sunday. So therefore, there will be no tafsir class next Saturday. I hope we meet next week. Jazakumullah khair. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala increase us in the knowledge of the deen. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless the knowledge that we got and make this knowledge testify for us, not against us, and help us to practice whatever we learn. May Allah Azza wa Jal bless you all, my dear brothers and sisters, and keep you safe and healthy. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive our sin, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala increase our good deeds and keep us firm in our religion. وآخر دعوانا أن الحمد لله رب العالمين وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.